Our next theorem is theorem 1.5, that is Euclid's lemma. The statement is if A divide BC and GCD of AB is equal to 1, then A divide C. So given that GCD of AB is equal to 1 and by using the condition for greatest common divisor, that is if GCD of AB is equal to D, then we can say that there exist integers x and y such that AX plus BY equal to D by theorem 1.2. So using this condition we can say that there exist integers x and y such that AX plus BY equal to 1, because here D is equal to 1, therefore AX plus BY equal to 1. So we multiply throughout by C, we will get ACX plus BCY equal to C. And given that A divide BC, also A divide AC, that implies A divide BCX and A divide ACX. Therefore, we can say that A divide the combination of ACX and BCX, that is A divide ACX plus BCX. ACX plus BCX is nothing but C. Therefore, we can say that A divide right hand side, that is A divide C. So, move on to next theorem 1.6. Every integer n greater than 1 is either a prime or product of primes. We use induction to prove this theorem, induction on n. We start with n equal to 2. And we know that 2 is a prime number, therefore the result directly holds for n equal to 2. We assume the result holds for all positive integers greater than n and less than n. That is, we assume for every integer less than n is either a prime or product of prime. So we consider the integer n. If n itself is a prime number, then there is nothing to prove. So we assume n is not a prime number. Then n must be a composite number. That is, n can be expressed as product of two numbers a and b, where the range of a is 1 less than a and b is strictly less than n. So n is a combination of two numbers and the two numbers are strictly less than n. And we assume that the result holds for the integer strictly less than n. That is, for every integer less than n, the numbers are either a prime or product of prime. Then therefore we can say that a and b are either a prime number or product of prime numbers. Therefore, their combination, their product is also product of prime numbers. That is, n is a product of primes. Therefore, every integer n greater than 1 is either a prime or product of primes. Move on to next theorem 1.7. There are infinitely many primes. So, we assume that there are only finitely many prime numbers. And let it be P1, P2, etc., Pn. So, we define a number m is equal to 1 plus P1 into P2 into etc., Pn. Then, clearly, m is strictly greater than 1, and by using the previous theorem, every integer greater than 1 is either a prime or product of prime. Therefore, we can say that m is either a prime or product of prime. And by the definition of m, we can say that m is not a prime number because m is greater than pi for all I equal to 1 to etc. n. And since there are only finitely many prime numbers up to Pn, we can say that m is not a prime number. Therefore, m must be product of prime. Since m is a product of prime, any of these prime number P1, P2, etc., Pn must divide m. So we assume like Pi divides m. That is, Pi divides 1 plus P1 into P2 into etc. Pn. That implies Pi must divide 1. Pi divide 1 means Pi equal to 1. That is, the prime number is equal to 1, which is not possible, which is a contradiction. Therefore, our assumption is wrong. Therefore, there is not finitely many prime, there are infinitely many prime numbers. Next theorem 1.8, if a prime P does not divide A, then GCD of P and A is 1. So we assume P does not divide A, and moreover we assume that GCD of P and A is D, which is strictly greater than 1. So we have to get a contradiction. So we, since D is equal to GCD of P and A, we can say that D divides P and the D divides A. Now, D divides P implies D is equal to 1 or P, because the only factor that divide a prime number is either 1 or that prime number itself, and we assume that D is strictly greater than 1. Therefore, this condition wrong, that is, D is not equal to 1. Therefore, we will get D is equal to P. Now, using this condition, that is, D divides A, we can say that P divides A. Instead of D, we can write P. Therefore, P divides A, which is a contradiction to our assumption, because we assume that the prime number does not divide A, which is a contradiction. Therefore, our assumption is wrong, for GCD of PA is equal to 1. Next theorem, if a prime P divides AB, then either P divides A or P divides B. So, we assume P divides A, and moreover, P does not divide A. So, we have to get P divides B. That is, P divides AB and P does not divide A means GCD of P and A is 1. Here we use Euclid's lemma. Euclid's lemma is, if A divide BC and GCD of AB is equal to 1, then A must divide C. The same condition is here, that is, P divides AB and GCD of PA is equal to 1, then by Euclid's lemma we can say that P must divide B. In the same way, we can say that if P divides AB and P does not divide B, then we will get P divides A. Next theorem, 1.10, fundamental theorem of arithmetic, which is an important theorem. The statement is, every integer n greater than 1 can be expressed as product of prime in one and only one way apart from the order of the factors. So there are two parts. First part is, every integer n greater than 1 can be represented as product of prime. And second part is, this is first part. Second part is, the representation must be unique way apart from the order of factors. This is the second part. In theorem 1.6, we already prove the first part, that is, we already state that every integer n greater than 1 is either a prime or product of prime. Therefore, first part is done by theorem 1.6. So we move on to second part, that is, the representation is unique. For that, we use induction on n. We consider n equal to 2. N equal to 2 is a prime number, and the unique representation is n equal to 2 itself. Therefore, the result holds for n equal to 2. And we assume the result holds for all integers less than n. That is, every integer less than n can be represented in a unique way. Now, we consider the integer n. If n is a prime number, then the result directly holds. So we assume n is not a prime number, then by using first part we can say that n must be a product of prime. So here we have to prove that that representation is unique. Here we assume there are two representation for n, that is, n is equal to p1 p2 etc pn, product of prime p1 p2 etc pn. Also n is equal to q1 q2 etc qt. That implies we can say that P1, P2, etc. Pn is equal to Q1, Q2, etc. Qt. So here we consider the first prime factor, that is P1. We have P1 divide right hand side, because right hand side is a product of P1. And the right hand side is equal to Q1, Q2, etc. Qt. Therefore we can say that P1 divide left hand side, that is Q1, Q2, etc. Qt. That is P1 divide Qi for some I. And without loss of generality, we assume that Qi is equal to the first prime number Q1. That is, P1 divide Q1. That implies P1 equal to Q1. Prime number divide another prime number means both the prime numbers are equal. So we can cancel P1 and Q1 from this representation. Therefore, we will get P2, P3, etc. Pn is equal to Q2, Q3, etc. Qt, which is strictly less than it, because n is equal to P1, P2, etc. Pn. We cancel the first prime number P1 and a Q1. Therefore, which is the combination is strictly less than n. And we assume that the result holds for all integers less than n. That is, for every integer less than n, the representation is unique. By using that hypothesis, we can say that n is equal to t. That is, the prime numbers q1, q2, etc., qt are nothing but p1, p2, etc., pn in a different order. Therefore, the representation is unique for n also. Hence, the proof. Move on to remark. Any positive integer n greater than 1 can be expressed as n equal to product I equal to 1 to infinity pi power ai, and this representation is called a canonical representation of positive integers in terms of primes. That is, product of prime power representation. This representation is canonical representation of a positive integer in terms of prime numbers. So, see you next class. Until then, bye.